Amen. Amen. Well, my son, he's our youngest of three. He has recently caught the soccer bug. And it's a little bit mind-blowing for me because I never had it growing up. And I played, I kind of did the typical, played one season when I was super young and was really bad at it and never did it again. Most of his passions have been things that I've kind of fed, right? Or he's caught from me. He see, Dad really loves this, so this is something that I want to try or do. Well, soccer's not one of those. I don't know where it came from. But I like it. It's fun. It's exciting. So he's playing right now, and we went to, we were doing some evaluation stuff a couple weeks ago, and we went to kind of really what was his first organized soccer effort. And I watched him the whole time out there, and he was doing great. They taught him this little move, a scissor move. Some of you who are soccer players probably know what I'm referring to. But, oh, he was so excited about that. And so I was talking to him. We got back in the car, and we were just kind of downloading everything. He said, man, I just hoped that they would teach me that bicycle kick today. And many of you in here may have no idea, well, what in the world is that? Well, that's when you see a soccer player jump up in the air. So a goal, the goal, right, their target is behind them. The ball's up here. They jump up in the air, kind of flip over, and kick that ball from there into the goal. So in other words, they're kicking while upside down in the air into the goal. So my son, at his very first organized soccer practice, that's really what he left hoping for. I just wanted to get that move. And I kind of told him, I said, and the truth is, he's an athletic kid. He's very coordinated. But at that level, I mean, really what he needs to be focused on is just controlling the ball, right? Running around and keeping the ball in front of him, dribbling the ball as he's running, moving around and keeping control of it, protecting it as he's passing other people, passing effectively. And I kind of tried to explain that to him, that really the greatest thing that you can do is learn that. But man, he had his eyes set. He was just like, I just really want to learn that bicycle kick. And, I think there's something within us, I think all of us, it changes shape and it looks different in different seasons of our life, for sure from childhood to adulthood, and even with men and women it kind of looks different, but we get distracted by complication. I think it's a little bit of a human condition, distraction by complication. We love the nuances. We love the nuances. We love diving deeply into the rabbit trails and then spending our time there. We love jumping to the most advanced ideas because oftentimes we get bored with the most simple. But you know, the interesting thing is, I think back on my education journey, and even as an undergraduate going to college and being a music student, music composition, writing music, I went into my first classes just wanting this desire to, man, I want to write some awesome and wacky, crazy music. And what they started us on, everybody, was we were going back to the most basic Bach chorales. That may mean nothing to you, but it's simple, basic music. Everybody had to start there. It doesn't matter how passionate you were about all this advanced, crazy, outside-the-box stuff, but you had to come back there. And you know what I found along the way as I continued in that is really the majority of my growth and development came from the focus on the most fundamental things. I even got to my doctoral work, and I thought, man, here we are, right? Doctoral study. This is, we are going to go down the most complicated and nuanced rabbit trails, and I was excited about that. But right where we started, the very first seminar that I ever went to, is they put these lists of books in front of us, and they said, these are the foundations of this area of study. Everyone who is in traveling this path of study must go through and wrestle with this basal literature, these foundational texts. And I found throughout my journey that those were the ones I always came back to. It wasn't all the little tributaries that I followed and maybe were fascinating, but when it really came down to it, I was constantly coming back to the most foundational of ideas. I think in the Christian life, we do the same. There's a lot of things that entice us. They're not bad things. I think a lot, and I've heard many times that people that get so passionate about prophecy and eschatology or how the world's going to end and when Jesus is coming back. It's a beautiful thing to think about. But sometimes those things can be a distraction from the most fundamental things. You see, the most fundamental thing of our faith is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I've also heard from people in having conversations with him that even about our church, Matt, we talk about the gospel all the time. Is there a time where we kind of move beyond that? And my thought is, sure, when there's a time that it no longer becomes relevant to our lives, we can move past it. The gospel of Jesus Christ is always relevant to our lives. You see, we can talk about how the world's going to end for a little while, but I can't trace back every single struggle that you're going through in your marriage and in your home, your parenting journey, your career. I can't trace that back to eschatology. I can trace it back to the gospel of Jesus Christ. I can trace every single struggle that we go to back to our understanding of the gospel. And so this morning, I want to challenge you with something. And that is, regardless of your background or where you're from or how long you've been around the church, if today's the very first day you've ever walked in a church or you've been around the church for 50 plus years and you've heard it all before, I want to challenge you that today, let's set aside all the rabbit trails and all the complication and let's dive deeply into the fundamental truth that not only is relevant to every single area of our lives, but the entire Bible from Genesis 1 all the way to the end of Revelation points. And that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. So instead of thinking this morning, oh, it's old news, let's realize the importance of it. I was in the gym working out one day, and after training, one of the guys that I train with asked me, obviously he knows what I do for a living, and he said, do you ever feel like you run out of things to say when you're preaching about the Bible or about Jesus? And I told him, I said, you know, no. Because here's the thing. The more I study and the more that I read, the more that I find and the more beautiful it becomes. It blew his mind, but it's the truth. And so this morning, if you're here thinking, oh, I've heard it. I know the gospel. I said that prayer 20 years ago. Hear my encouragement today. Let's dive deeply into the most fundamental truth of Christianity and ask today, how is it changing the way that we live every single day of our lives? If you have a Bible, let's go to John chapter 19. This is where we've been for some time. We've been traveling through the Gospel of John. And we get today to 19, one more week, I believe, of 19, and we'll finish this chapter. We'll finish the book of John, believe it or not, here within the next several months before summer. And as we begin reading this morning, I want to give just a little, in case this is your first week with us. We're beginning in chapter 19, verse 28 is where we pick up today. However, the first words we see there is after this. So I just want to catch up a tiny bit, very quickly, 100 miles an hour, is what after this is talking about. So you look back, and so Jesus has been taken, and he's gone through a Jewish trial, right? He went to the high priest or the individual who was actually acting as the high priest at that point, and they wanted to kill him. Their desire, the Jews, was to see Jesus crucified. And there's only one way for that to happen, and that is for the Roman leadership to make that pronouncement on him of capital punishment. And so they rush through their little Jewish trial, and they know they have to get him to Pilate as quickly as possible, and they do so. They get him to Pilate, and Pilate, as we've looked at for the past several weeks, is there. He's kind of trying to appease them, but as he's trying to appease them, saying, look, I don't find anything wrong with what I see here in this situation. I'll beat him a little, and then I'll bring him back out and say, are you sure? And that's what we've been looking at, and then he comes back out, and he's kind of in this give and take with the Jews, but they keep coming back saying, no, crucify him, crucify him. And so Pilate kind of does this passive-aggressive move, we might call it, of, okay, I'm going to crucify him as you've asked because I don't want to get in trouble by those who supervise me, yet I'm still going to demonstrate to you that I don't think this is the best way to go by the sign that he puts on the cross and just the way he communicates with the Jews all throughout. And so last week we looked at the moment where Jesus marches up and they find him with, of course, the vertical stake already in the ground up there at Golgotha, and they lift him, hoist him up on there, attaching that cross beam that was carried up there. And Jesus is on the cross. The last words that we finished with last week was this adoption language that we saw Jesus use with his mom. So we pick up in verse 28, and it says, after this, of course, after all these things have happened, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch, and they held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head, and he gave up his spirit. What John wants us to know here, as we're reading with this language, to fulfill the scriptures, I thirst. John wants us to know that all of these things are not only happening in fulfillment of the scripture, but I think what we're seeing here is John letting us know that Jesus is doing this aware of himself fulfilling the scriptures. So the things that he's doing when he says, I thirst, Jesus is aware. He's saying, I thirst, and he's fulfilling the scriptures. John wants us to connect those dots. And I think that's an important thing that we're going to come back to here in a minute. But so we see this hyssop branch that's raised up after Jesus' exclamation of I thirst. The hyssop was, it was like a shrub that grew wild out of the crevices of a mountain. Maybe those of you who have been around the hill country, you've seen something that looked like little crazy branches that will come out of a hill or out of rock. And so hyssop would have been something like that. It's actually a very weak branch, but Jesus wasn't very high up, so maybe contrary to what some of our contemporary art would display of Jesus being on the cross super high in the air, he wasn't high. He didn't need to be high, right? He was up there suspended, and he couldn't breathe being up on the cross. So they would have been able to reach him, not needing some huge, sturdy branch, but with this light hyssop branch. And so, so it's raised up to Jesus, held to his mouth. And so Jesus receives this, and there you get the timing again. After receiving that, now he says, it is finished. Tetelestai, we have that in other gospels, and it's an interesting idea because you and I might read that, and we might think, it is finished. In other words, we might think, I give up. Oftentimes in our own lives, I don't know about you as parents, but we're journeying through life, Lori and I, and we've got three wonderful kids, but we do have moments every once in a while where they aren't perfect. And sometimes we have moments every once in a while where all three of them aren't perfect at the same time. And so we get to this place where you might hear one of us just go, I am finished, right? And it's just kind of an exclamation. And in other words, what we're saying, we're not serious, right? We don't really give up. We're not leaving them. But we're saying, in a sense, I give up. I'm exhausted. Okay, that's not the same it is finished that's going on here with Jesus. He's not saying, I'm done, I've been defeated, I give up. What he's saying is, and it is finished, tetelestai, the mission that has been given to me, I have accomplished. So in other words, he's saying, I have accomplished it. I've done it. The mission that the Father has sent me to accomplish here has been accomplished. We see that in John chapter 17, verse 4 and 5, John 10, 17 through 18. We've talked about this and what Jesus was sent to do by the Father. He goes and he does it to glorify the Father. So this is the culmination of that and the exclamation from Christ of this mission of my life and my death now. It is accomplished. We pick up in verse 31, and it says, since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and they broke the legs of the first and the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. You know, so in the Jews' mind, back from their law in Deuteronomy chapter 21, we know that they believed that if a man was crucified and left overnight, that would defile the land. And so they wanted to make sure that the individual was dead and then removed. See, the Romans didn't care. We know from history that when they crucified an individual, they would leave them up there until either they asphyxiated or the sun exposure or the vultures would kill them. But with the Jews, because of this belief, we can't leave them overnight, they would go and they would have one of the guards take what you and I would call a large sledgehammer, and they would break their legs so that the individual on the cross could not push themselves up to fill their lungs with air. If they couldn't push themselves up, then they're going to asphyxiate. But they came to Jesus as they were there, and they find that Jesus is already dead. And you may be asking, why was Jesus dead here and the other two not? Well, there's a lot of reasons, but most practical would have been the floggings that he experienced that I don't believe the others did. We talked about this last week. He had an initial flogging, but then he had the worst flogging, where was probably the reason that he couldn't carry that crossbeam as he marched up to Golgotha, was that there were literally chunks of flesh and muscle ripped off from those bones that were in the whip that beat him and then pulled it off. So Jesus here is dead. In verse 34, one of the soldiers, they pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you may also believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. Think back to what we saw earlier in John's writing here. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, another scripture says, they will look on him who they have pierced. So likely the piercing of the side, they didn't break his legs because they knew he was dead, but there needed to be confirmation. And so I've read a lot of things of people, they don't really know exactly where that piercing went. Most people say that it was heart and lungs, and the fluid that had accumulated in his lungs was the water-like substance that came out, and the blood, of course, from his heart. When we get to verse 35, I think it's an amazing moment in the Bible. There are moments, and it's much like what I spoke of earlier that I shared with my friend at the gym, that the more you look at it, the more you're blown away by it. And I came to this moment this week, and it was one that gave me pause. And it may just fly past most of you in here, but I found it incredible, because this is a moment in this gospel that we've been traveling through for over 2 years. We've taken breaks. If you're new, don't get scared. But we've been going through the Gospel of John for a long time. And here we see a different moment by the author, John, when he says, he who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true. He's talking about himself here. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth. So John, after writing this and after reflecting on this reality, is what I can't help but read as being moved to a place to make a invitation here to anyone that reads his gospel, and he says, that you may also believe. John says, I was there, I saw this happen, I'm writing this, I'm connecting the dots so that you who read this and find this true, so that you might believe. I find that so beautiful. The author here, John himself, is going to speak to us this morning and extend us a challenge that says, I wrote down the details and I wrote down the events and I've written this story and it's all true and I've done it and I've provided it so that you might find belief. So my question this morning, as we look at that and as we wrestle with, I think, what John is challenging us to, is how do we accept John's invitation to us? How do we accept this invitation from John delivered to us that you might believe? All of this, he says, delivered so that you might believe. And regardless of where you are in the church or where you say that you repeated the prayer or whether you call yourself a Christian or not, I don't care about any labels. I think every single one of us this morning can respond to John's invitation that we might believe
differently today after reflecting on the gospel of Jesus Christ. So here's the things. If you have a worship guide this morning, these are in that worship guide if you want to follow along. In the first, so how do we accept John's invitation? I think John would say that we believe Jesus was and is the Son of God. That Jesus was and is the Son of God. We can look back at chapter 17, verse 4 and 5. I glorified you on earth. This is the high priestly prayer, Jesus praying to the Father, having accomplished the work that you have given me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. And so John, as he's saying, I wrote all of this so that you might believe. I think this is one of the fundamental truths that John is going back to and saying, this is what I want you to believe. This is what I've written. This is what I have intentionally provided for you. All the way back to John chapter 1, those of you who are with us when we started this journey, you remember the words, and the Word became flesh. Right there in the beginning, John chapter 1, verse 14, John was already showing us that God himself came and he became man and flesh. The Word became flesh. Logos, the same description of Jesus is used in Revelation chapter 19, verse 13. I love this quote from J.I. Packer. He says this, I'll read it to you. This is from Knowing God, probably one of, if you can give one of his writings the best, that may be it. He says this, here are two mysteries for the price of one. The plurality of persons within the unity of God and the union of Godhead and manhood in the person of Jesus. Nothing in fiction is so fantastic as is this truth of the incarnation. Nothing in fiction is so fantastic as the truth of the incarnation. So as we're asking the question, John, what are you saying here? What do you want us to believe? You've written all of this. You've provided all of this. And God, by his great sovereignty and the work of the Holy Spirit, has protected this document over time. And here we are, 2017, January. We're reading this. John, what would you have us believe? I think John would say, one, that we believe that Jesus was and is the Son of God. And this is significant for so many different reasons. And just as a church right now, I'll just kind of apply this to us here gathered in Christ's name, and that is that there is no man who has authority or is the authority in his church, but rather it is Christ, Jesus himself, who has authority in his church. Now, if he wasn't the Son of God, or if he was just some other man or just some other special prophet, then the authority of the church would be in another man. It's not. It is in Jesus Christ and Christ alone. No man rules the bride of Christ, but Christ himself. The second thing I think John would have us believe is that we believe that Jesus was punished and killed at the will of the Father. Jesus was punished and killed at the will of the Father. You see, if you remember back to John chapter 19, verse 11, I'll start reading in verse 10. It says, so Pilate said to him, he's saying to Jesus, they're in this initial conversation, you'll not speak to me, but don't you know that I have authority, Pilate saying, to release you and authority to crucify you? And Jesus answered him, you would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. I think John wants us to know, John wants us to believe, to be able to say that we believe that Jesus was punished and killed at the will of the Father. Isaiah 53:10, which John would have been intimately familiar with, says most literally, it was the will of the Lord to crush him. Acts 2:23, which we've looked at often, Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. It wasn't the Jews who had this novel idea to be able to march Jesus and persuade their high priest and then persuade Pilate. And it wasn't Pilate who had the authority to do it, but it was the will of the Father as the Father was moving. And the beautiful thing about this entire story is as God's moving all the way through each piece, each chess move, moving forward, whether it was the Jews at the high priest's house or it was before Pilate, every single move was in pursuit of the reconciliation of your life. You see, if all of that wouldn't have happened just as it did, and Jesus would not have died as he did, there would be no reconciliation and hope out of the hopelessness and death in sin. And so as we look back at all of these events and we look back and we think, yes, it was the will of the Father, John wants us to know and understand that we must believe that it was God who put him up on that cross. Well, then it was God who was pursuing you and me through every single conversation and step of the way. That's the love of God. I think third, we ask the question, John, what are you saying? What do you want us to believe? I think third, we would say that we believe that Jesus is every promise fulfilled. I already highlighted some of that to you as we were reading this morning. We've seen it constantly and over again as we've worked through this. John, I think really more than any other gospel writer, does the job of explicitly connecting the dots to the promises of Jesus. Here's the spot. Jesus fulfilled this promise. As we said, we have that parenthetical words this morning right there in 19:28. After this, Jesus, knowing all was now finished, said, and then John says parenthetically, to fulfill the scriptures. We see it over and over again. We read it down there at the end. This took place so the scripture might be fulfilled down in verse 36. That Jesus is every promise fulfilled. We can go all the way back to Genesis 3:15, and the seed of the woman, the descendant of Eve, will crush the head of the serpent, being victorious. Jesus, the descendant of Eve, all the way down through David. 2 Samuel 7, verse 12, there'll be one greater than David who comes along and rules, and his kingdom will have no end. Deuteronomy 18, there's one greater than Moses who's going to come. Isaiah 53, the whole thing, read it and begin to bask in the realities that all of those promises one by one were fulfilled in Jesus. And so when we read and we find John say, hey, I wrote all of this, I moved through all this by the work of the Holy Spirit through me, but I did this so that you might believe. The invitation is to believe that Jesus is every promise fulfilled. I think in my mind as I wrestle through this, our middle child loves right now to play tic-tac-toe. And there's kind of an intellectual plateau that you reach with tic-tac-toe, right? Hopefully I'm not surprising any of you in here with this. But you get to a place with tic-tac-toe where you either, if you're playing with your child, maybe you consent to lose. Or if you're really playing, you're going to tie every time. Well, she's gotten to that place where every time you play with her, she's going to tie with you. She's figured it out unless you consent to lose. I feel like what John is doing here, as he's beautifully, obviously, by the sovereign work of our Father in heaven, as he's putting these pieces together, what he's saying to us is, I'm removing any doubt that you can have. Hey, you know, this promise, it was fulfilled. Hey, this, you know, when this happened, this tiny thing like Jesus saying, I thirst, it happened to fulfill the promises that have been given. With every single move and articulation of John, he's saying, you have no reason not to have every single confidence in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our scriptures are beautiful. I think number four, asking the question, John, what are you saying? What would you have us believe would be that we believe Jesus suffered fully and died completely? Think about the way that John writes about the crucifixion. You see, we know that the punishment for sin is death, right? It's Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. So as we look back and we see the way that John describes the death of Jesus, there can be no doubt that Jesus took the punishment that he took, and he was completely and fully dead. He paid the entire price for sin, right? His side was pierced. Blood and water came out after they had already came to him and realized that this man's already dead. We don't need to break his legs. Jesus died completely and fully, which was the only possible way that you and I could be reconciled, because the wages of sin is death. Somebody had to die. Someone had to die to pay the price for our sin. The way Paul describes it in Romans chapter 3 is, for God to be righteous, which he is, someone had to pay the price. And so God, proving himself to be a righteous God, friends, the God that we worship is righteous. He proved himself righteous by sending his only son to die and pay the price for sin, death completely, so that you and I might be rescued and have life. Fifth, we're asking the question, John, what are you writing? What are you asking us to believe? We believe, he would want us to believe in the supremacy of the kingdom of God. Now, these are kind of out of order, but we look back up in chapter 18 and verse 36. We see Jesus describe that his kingdom's not of this world. He said, if I would have really been, this is the Matt Amplified version, if I would have really been a political revolutionary, Pilate, then there would have been other people fighting for me, but I'm not, so other people aren't fighting a battle for me. My kingdom is not of this world. That's what he shares with Pilate. John wants us to know and believe that in the supremacy of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of Christ is eternal. The kingdom of this world is temporary and it's perishable. You see, when we believe in the gospel, when we believe in the gospel, we no longer live for the things of this world, but we live towards the things of our glorious King, Jesus. You see, when we really believe in the gospel, we believe that we are not individuals that are of this world. We are here, and we're in it, we're called, and we're given a mission, but our greatest pursuits in life supersede the pursuits of this perishable world. That's what John, I think, is inviting us to believe here as we look back over what he has written in the picture that he's painted. And so the question that I have for us this morning, it's really two questions. They fit together. And that is, do you believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ? Do you believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ? And if after hearing this and after hearing me say, I don't care how long you've been around the church or how long you've been a Christian or what kind of prayer you prayed, if maybe you're thinking, well, how do I really know? Well, then I'll lead you to the second question, which is, does the gospel of Jesus Christ exert constant change upon your life? Does the gospel of Jesus Christ exert constant change upon your life? You see, because a belief in the gospel demands constant sanctification is one word. Maybe simplified where we understand it, what we often say, transformation. A belief in the gospel demands constant change in every area of our life. So if you're in here this morning and you say, yes, I believe in the gospel, then we should be able to have a conversation about how the realities of the gospel are transforming you and your marriage and your parenting journey. But if you're in here this morning and you say, well, I thought I was. I've always said I was a Christian. I've been in the church. I grew up in the church, but I don't feel any change or interaction with the gospel of Jesus Christ in my life, then I would say, come back. Let's talk about this. Place your faith in Jesus, feel the joy of being rescued and know him well and begin to walk in the beauty of being transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. One of my favorite authors is a guy named Thomas Friedman. I'll say favorite. I enjoy reading his stuff. He wrote a book, The World is Flat. It was the second book of his that I read, and he attributes these dates back to the greatest change. I think I've referenced his books before in sermons, but he throws out a date, and I'll throw it out to you, and I guarantee you that there might be one of you, if that, who knows any of the significance of this date, and it's 8-9-1989, I believe. No, 95. 8-9, see, I didn't even know. 8-9, August 9th, 1995. He traces the world that we live in back to that date. And that date is the day Netscape went public. Well, many of you in here, depending on your age, you don't even know what Netscape is. That date was the day that we went from being just a PC-driven world, personal computer, to an internet-driven world.
And he traces everything that we are in our culture back to that change from being a personal computer-driven culture to an internet-driven culture and all the things that we're going through. And he says it's the greatest thing that ever happened in history that has had the greatest change upon history. And I love Friedman. But when I read that and I reflect on it, I want to say, hey, Thomas, you missed it. That day, even though we all live in a day that it's been changed radically by the invention and our dependency on the internet, it pales in comparison to the day that the Son of God came as the Lamb to take away the sins of the world and died on the cross, reconciling us out of hopelessness and into life. That day literally has changed everything for all time. So this morning, regardless of your story, regardless of your background, my invitation to you is to respond to the gospel of Jesus. Every single heart and mind in here, from me to every one of you, can respond to the invitation of being moved and transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to invite you to bow your head and close your eyes. And as we pray this morning, I'll be available in the front along with other prayer leaders. I invite you to respond, and if the Holy Spirit's doing something in your heart, I invite you to come up, grab one of us, and allow us to pray with you. Maybe if you're standing around a small group leader or even your spouse, grab them, pray with them, respond to the gospel. Just as we're in this spirit of response, I just want to connect a dot for you from last Sunday. I believe that there is no way possible to live a life in habitual and unrepentant sin while living a life that gazes upon the punishment that Jesus took to rescue us. So this morning, if you're wrestling through, how do I respond to the gospel? Think about what took place in his rescue, pursuit, loving redemption of your soul. And I guarantee you, the Spirit will spark you to respond. Whenever you're ready this morning, I invite you to these tables to take the bread and dip it in the cup, representing Christ's body that was broken for you. Dip in the cup, which represents his blood, that blood that poured out of his body on that day. If you've placed your faith in Jesus, if you believe, you're welcome at these tables. If you haven't come to that place of belief, I'd encourage you to talk to us, ask somebody, tap on a shoulder around you. Father, we love you. We're so humbled and thankful for your gospel, for your loving pursuit of us by the mind-blowing gift of your Son that you gave, going from the highest of highs, Father, by your side, humbling himself to the point of death on the cross. Father, all to fill that gap between you as a completely righteous, sinless, glorious God and our sinful, wicked condition. Father, I pray for belief this morning. Every heart, every mind, every story, every label. God, I pray for belief. May we respond to John's invitation delivered to us by the Holy Spirit this morning.